I've sat here listening. I'm glad to be last in rank. I get to listen to all the testimony. And what's become clear to me, there are a few things, and that is that the censorship efforts of the big tech, the intelligence community, and the media were all working in concert to affect the 2020 election. I find it unbelievably ironic, and I hope others do too, see the irony that people who were so concerned and hell-bent and worried about the interference of outside groups on the 2016 election became willing participants to interfere in the following presidential election. These three groups worked together, and it's clear, worked hand in hand to hide the truth from the American people. The fact that the FBI had the Hunter Biden laptop, heck, it was in their possession for a year before the election, is appalling. But that didn't stop them from spreading a lie and a bogus claim about it being Russian interference again. And you know, it's clear to me why they reached out to you, because they knew you would buy the lie. They knew that an organization with 99% of its employees donating to Democratic candidates and efforts would absolutely not look at any information with a jaundiced eye. You would take it as the gospel truth. And so they knew that, because it was clear from your tweets before that you have an opinion about the president, you have an opinion about the Republican Party. And so when all of that leading up to the October 14, 2020, when the New York Post published its story, everything was already in place. So, Mr. Roth, my question to you is, when 51 intelligence officials told us that the Hunter Biden laptop was Russian disinformation, the Democrats, the mainstream media, the president, all repeated this lie. Now that you know what you know years later, do you still believe that the Hunter Biden laptop is not real? Or do you believe it's real?
Sir, I never held that belief.
Do you believe that the story is Russian disinformation?
No, sir. I didn't then, and I don't now.
Okay. I have a question for Mr. Baker. You started your role as a Twitter's deputy general counsel in June of 2020, correct?
Yes, sir.
Who hired you for that role?
Who specifically hired me? My boss was a person named Sean Edgett, who was the general counsel.
Sean Edgett?
Edgett.
E-G-E-T-T. And that's who you interviewed with?
I interviewed with numerous people, but Sean was my boss.
Anyone that comes to mind outside of Sean?
Ms. Gotti, I interviewed with. You're saying other people that I interviewed with at Twitter?
But ultimately, the hiring agent was Sean Edgett.
I'm not sure exactly who made the decision, to be frank with you, but Sean was my boss.
Okay. My next question is, when you were fired from Twitter in December of 2022, after the release of the first installment of the Twitter files, did you destroy any internal communications related to that first batch of the Twitter files?
As I said in my testimony, I didn't destroy any documents, period.
What reason were you fired?
You'll have to ask Mr. Musk about that.
You were not given any information?
He made a public statement about it in a tweet, but I think you would have to ask him for the precise reason.
Okay, thank you. Back to Mr. Roth. Is it true that Twitter whitelisted accounts for the Department of Defense to spread propaganda about its efforts in the Middle East? Did they give you a list of accounts that were fake accounts and asked you to whitelist those accounts?
That request was made of Twitter. To be clear, when I found out about that activity, I was appalled by it. I undid the action, and my team exposed activity originating from the Department of Defense's campaign publicly. We've shared that data with the world, and research about it has been published.
Was that only in efforts against foreign entities, or were there any efforts against citizens of the United States?
I think the nature of public social media activity means that anybody might have seen it, but my understanding was the activity was predominantly focused outside of the United States.
Okay. Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, I want to just say thank you for this hearing. I would like, I would hope that we would be asking for documents or in communications, whether it's on personal devices or private devices, between these individuals and government officials.